Welcome to the Massachusetts School of Law Educational Forum. Thank you for joining us. This program is brought to you by the Massachusetts School of Law and is shown nationwide. The topic for today's show is Title IX. Congress enacted Title IX in 1972. It provides in part that no person in the United States shall, on the basis of sex, be excluded from participation in, be denied the benefits of, or be subjected to discrimination under any education program or activity receiving federal financial assistance. So for over 30 years, courts and athletic programs at colleges and universities have struggled to bring equality to female student athletes. However, many of us don't understand that Title IX ensures equal opportunity at every level of the education process, including science, technology, engineering, and mathematics disciplines. Joining me to discuss Title IX is Catherine Piernik, the Assistant Director of Academic Programs and Director of the Women's Engineering Program at the University of Notre Dame. Catherine is a lawyer, and she is the author of a terrific article about Title IX on which this program is based. Welcome to our show.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Also joining me today to discuss women in science is Caitlin Burke, a 2004 graduate of Colby College, where she majored in biology and biochemistry, and she was captain of the women's basketball team. Currently, Caitlin is working as a researcher and taking grad courses in her field. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
And I'm Diane Sullivan, your host for today's program. Catherine, tell us a little bit about Title IX.
Well, Title IX, as you said in the opening, was enacted in 1972. And what it really did was fill a gap in existing civil rights legislation. In 1964, when Congress passed the big Civil Rights Act of 1964, Title VI provided for non-discrimination on the basis of race in educational programs and activities that receive federal financial assistance, and also in employment. Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 prohibits discrimination on the basis of sex in employment. But there was a gap in that legislation because nothing in that law prohibited discrimination on the basis of sex in educational programs or activities. So colleges and universities weren't really adhering to even the spirit of the civil rights legislation in terms of faculty hiring, student admissions, and things like that. And so in the early 1970s, Congress passed this law to fill that gap. Throughout most of the rest of the 1970s, the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare, later the Department of Education, spent time trying to figure out the regulations and how to implement the law in colleges and universities. And by the late 1980s, we started seeing some emphasis on enforcing Title IX's mandates with regard to athletic programs in colleges and universities. But other than what Title IX did initially in academic programs, which was pretty much open the doors of colleges and universities to women where they had previously been excluded in programs such as medicine and law and engineering, we haven't really seen much in the past 33 years of Title IX and its application to the academic side of the educational enterprise.
In fact, most of the lawsuits and the investigations surrounding Title IX have focused either on sexual harassment or sports. Am I correct about
exactly.
that?
Exactly.
One more fact before we talk with Caitlin. Let me ask you a question. 1972, Title IX is enacted. How many women were in engineering programs throughout the country?
Well, according to the National Science Foundation, in 1972, 492 women nationwide earned bachelor's degrees in engineering that year, which was something in the neighborhood of 1% of all engineering graduates that year.
You know, I read that in your piece and I said, did I get that right? Did I understand that? Caitlin, tell us about you. Tell us a little bit about yourself and your career in the science field.
Well, I've always been interested in sciences and especially biology, and throughout my career I've been interested in medicine, and so just studying it in college seemed like the next step, and currently the next step was going on to research from there and just sort of figuring things out, exactly what I want to do. But it's very interesting, and look for challenges and just trying to understand a lot of aspects of cellular and molecular biology.
I'm intrigued. How does a young girl who's a jock besides grow up to want to be a researcher?
I don't really know. I guess I really had a great experience in high school with my biology professor. Mm-hmm. And just through, you know, different professors at Colby, I just enjoyed the classes and always wanted to learn more. So I don't know, I think I was just encouraged in that way through my family and through different experiences, different people that I've had the opportunity to meet. But I can't really pick out anything specific, but it's just always been an open opportunity for me and I've always been intrigued by it.
Wonderful sign of the times. Were there a lot of other girls in your classes?
In the biology classes, definitely. There's, I feel as though, and definitely in the chemistry side of my classes, there was less, but a lot of girls were in the biology field. In fact, I want to say there was more than 50% in most of my biology classes were girls.
Oh, great. Catherine, Title IX violations in athletics are much more readily apparent, at least I believe they are. They're also more easily remedied. You just throw money at the program and you seem to be able to solve the problem.
Right.
Academic violations have to be much harder, one, to see, and two, to fix.
It's definitely true that they're harder to see. There was a recent article in the Chronicle of Higher Education discussing the issue of equity in particular academic disciplines, and they were talking about programs like physics and economics. And what one of the faculty members interviewed for the article had to say was that the sort of discrimination that's occurring in academic programs right now is below everybody's radar screen. It's almost imperceptible. But unless you look for it, you're not going to find it, and you're not going to find ways to be able to fix it until you have a hugely public problem with a program, as Duke University did a couple years ago with its physics department. And they've taken some very public and proactive steps to fix what was wrong with their physics department. But until something public happens, it's really hard to identify.
How do you go about changing the mindsets of the people who operate these programs and have for decades, Catherine, in which this type of discriminatory attitude really prevails?
I think at the first level, it's education. Yeah. Because I have spoken to, over the last couple of months, several groups of graduate students at the University of Notre Dame. And I can tell you from firsthand experience that when our students or our faculty members bring up something that looks discriminatory, we jump right on it and fix it. We have a culture at the university that is not going to tolerate people not being treated appropriately. So when something arises, we take care of it. But the last two groups of graduate students in particular I've had a chance to talk to aren't even aware that they have particular rights, aren't even aware that certain conduct is wrong. And it's not just graduate students, it's faculty too.
Sure.
And so I think education is the first place to start, making people aware of the fact that Title IX isn't just about athletics. As a matter of fact, there are 43 regulations relevant to Title IX in the Code of Federal Regulations, and only 1.5 of them have anything to do with athletics. The other 41.5 have to do with academic programs, and nobody's looking at them. And if you read the regulations, you find some interesting things that you might not have thought about that could be discriminatory. You don't intend to discriminate, but you're doing something that you've done out of habit, or you've done out of custom, or you've done because you haven't even thought of another way to do it. And it is discriminatory, but somebody needs to tell you that it might be, and you need to think about a different way to do it.
You know, Catherine, I'm a lawyer, and I care about the women's issues. Mm-hmm. I did not understand that Title IX extended to education. If I don't have it,
right.
I don't think most people do.
Right.
Did you know?
I had no idea.
Yeah?
I had no
idea
at all.
But you knew that it applied to basketball.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Has women's participation in science, engineering, technology, and math increased substantially since Title IX? It is my understanding from the research I did getting ready for the show that in the early 60s, about 3% of the scientists were women. Mm-hmm. Probably going back 2 years, the number was approaching 20%. Mm-hmm. Is that accurate?
Those numbers are accurate, but I think sometimes those numbers don't tell us the whole story. Mm-hmm. In engineering, for example, you know, we talked that in 1972 women comprised 1% of engineering graduates. Today they comprise about 20% of engineering graduates. However, the number of women graduating with engineering degrees in this country has remained stagnant since 1987. Between 1972 and 1987, the number increased from 492 to something in the neighborhood of 11,000. Today, we're still only graduating 11,000 women. And the only reason the percentage of women has gotten bigger is that the number of men graduating has decreased.
Yeah.
So since 1987, for the last 18 years, we've seen absolutely no growth. And the indications that we're getting from the various government agencies that collect these statistics show that we might actually start seeing the beginning of a decline in those numbers now.
Wow. I'll be interested in your opinion on that. Caitlin, do you have any opinion on why women are less likely to pursue these disciplines?
I don't know. I mean, I definitely don't think that there's anything, outright about it. There's no outright discrimination that I've noticed, but it's hard to say that there aren't a lot of women in the leadership roles in research, yeah. especially. And I think maybe that portrays an image that women aren't gonna make it that far, or just, I don't know, it's hard to say.
We'll talk more about this a little bit later, but in your classes mm-hmm. at Colby, were there a lot of women as professors, as faculty in your science classes?
Yes, again, in the biology especially. Mm-hmm. It was about 50-50, but in the other disciplines, not. I can't even think of too many in the math, chemistry or physics, maybe one or two in each, but definitely the percentages are very low in those areas. And think that might have a lot to do with it. I think biology, I had great mentors, and I was very close with one of the women professors that I had, and she was a great guiding force for mm-hmm. me and for my research. And if I didn't have her, might not have gone where I've gone, so I don't know.
And Catherine, you write a lot about that, the importance mm-hmm. of mentors, the importance of faculty giving equal time to the women students and really supporting them.
Right, and it's not even necessarily the same sort of contact that female students need from their faculty members as male students need from their faculty members. I can go into the athletics example right now, and we know that women need to be coached differently than men need to be coached. You can't take the coaching principles you use for a men's team and apply them to a women's team and expect the same level of success. So why should we think that we can apply the same boot camp mentality or whatever you want to call it in terms of training students in the academic disciplines that we have been using with men successfully for the last 80 or 90 mm-hmm. years and think that that's going to work with women?
Is there any possibility, I'll ask both of you this question, that the lack of women in certain science fields, in engineering and math and technology, is a result of personal preference?
I think absolutely. But where does that personal preference come from? Where does it develop? And if it starts with a junior high school math teacher saying that girls can't do math, at some point you don't even know you've heard it, but by the time you get to college, math isn't even on your radar screen right. anymore. Caitlin talked a lot about the people who influenced her ability to make this decision. Clearly, you had people who were important in making sure that you got what you needed to get where you needed to go. But a lot of girls, we had a junior high school group of girls come for a day of engineering and science activities at school, and the female teacher who was with the group wanted to take a picture of this group of girls working on their project, and she said to show their math teacher that girls can build things because he doesn't believe it.
Terrific.
So how do these personal preferences develop?
Yeah.
Some people maybe truly are more interested in one thing than another, but do you get more interested because you don't think you can do something else?
Your opinion, Caitlin?
I definitely think it takes a strong person to work through that kind of adversity where you're being told repeatedly or, outright or not, that you're not supposed to be doing this. And I've had great experiences, but I definitely know that there's girls that have gone through experiences where they were scared away from things. And if this is your drive, then yeah, you will go on to this. But if you're hearing it again repeatedly, maybe you start to question a little more and think other roads seem a little bit easier and you don't pursue those things.
I knew from the time I was knee high that I wanted to be an attorney. And you knew for a long time that you had interest in the science field. And I think what you're saying is probably accurate. If you combine that at a crucial time when people are telling you you're not good in this, that would be a deterrence, a major deterrence.
Right, and we do know that girls will make decisions about math and science as early as 11 and 12 years old. Mm-hmm. How much information does an 11-year-old girl have about the world around her to know that she's just not going to do math after, sixth grade? Mm-hmm. And she's going to do what she needs to do to get through school and get her diploma or whatever, but she's not going to do anything more. And so I think there's a certain point at which we're shortchanging girls by really letting them off the hook that early. Because when they get into college, then their options are severely limited.
Sure. Do women trade off career, high earnings, and demanding careers, like a research field, because they know they want to have a family, and to juggle both work and family, it's a trade-off, and so they choose probably not to pursue these types of endeavors?
I think it's an active trade-off. Mm-hmm. This group of graduate students that I just met with yesterday, I heard from a lot of them that they were concerned about being able to combine a career and family. But then if you look at the law, the question that I have is, why does it have to be an endeavor, a career path, such that you can't combine both? It right now is, because the men who have been in it haven't had to make those trade-offs. But does science research or engineering research really have to be as demanding a field that doesn't allow people to have human lives outside of it? And I think those are the questions that we're not asking. When you ask about the kinds of things that go on in these departments to dissuade women, these are the kinds of questions that people need to start asking. And maybe by making changes that benefit women, they're going to make changes that make the field more accessible to a whole range of people.
That benefit mankind.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's what they're beginning, we hope, to do, at least in medicine. And that's why you have as many women in medicine as you do, I think.
Right. And law the same way, too. I think law firms are getting to be a little more flexible on the partnership track and that sort of thing. So women are seeing more opportunities in that field. But there's such a rigid progression of what you have to do to finally be a success in a science or engineering field that it's daunting to sit there at 22 years old and look at how you're going to be 36 or 37 before you're tenured.
And you hear the biological clock tick, mm-hmm. tick, 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 tick.
Yeah, I've definitely had multiple people, you know, I've been, you know, trying to decide. I'm doing research right now. I'm not really sure exactly what I want to do next. And I've definitely had multiple people giving me advice and saying, well, think about what you want to do in 10 years. Think about what your family life want, what you want your family life to be like. And that is a huge part of, you know, being a woman and being in science and, you know, being in any career. It's hard to think about, what do you want in 10 years? I don't know what I want next week, you know.
It's good the men don't have to make these hard decisions, isn't it? I wonder if faculty, more women in the top positions within the educational institution and faculty would solve a lot, large part of this problem.
I think it would. I think that the more women you have in leadership positions that can be sensitive to the issues that everybody really faces. I mean, we tend to focus on women's issues because we deal with women who are caring for children. But we also are starting to see, obviously now, men are having issues with dealing with aging parents and that kind of thing. So we're going to have, and plus everybody has personal lives they want to live too. Whether you're raising children or whether you want to go live in the Alps for a couple of months every spring or whatever it is you want to do. And so I think when we get more women into these positions, we will start to see that we're going to get more questioning about, why does it have to be this way? Why are there these rigid rules that have to be followed that really are exclusionary? The government accounting office put out a report last year about Title IX and one of the engineering and science disciplines, and they attributed 91% of the salary differences between men and women to the personal choices men and women make. But what they're not accounting for is what's driving these men and women to make these personal choices.
Absolutely.
And the systems are doing that.
When we come back from break, I want to talk with you about how do we change the predominance of male faculty members in these disciplines. So to our viewing audience, please stay tuned. We'll be right back.
You know, I was there when Dr. King shared his dream with the world.
I have a dream today.
And I was there when we launched Men to the Moon.
Lift off.
I was even there when Mark McGuire broke the home run record. Yep, I've seen a lot in my day. Thanks to television, of course.
Dad, where are you going?
I'm gonna play a little golf.
Why?
Because it's Saturday, and that's the day that Dad plays golf.
Why?
Because I really like golf.
But why?
Well, good question. Because most of the time, I just spend the day chasing a little white ball around the course.
Why?
Well, usually it's because I hit the ball into the rough or out of bounds.
Why?
I don't know. Sometimes I wonder why I even took up this game. Maybe I'll cut back a little.
Why?
Well, for starters, maybe I could spend a few more Saturdays doing something with you.
Hey, Dad?
Huh?
When?
Family. Isn't it about time? From the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. You know how inquisitive kids are. That's why you store sharp objects in a safe place. Keep medicines out of reach. And if you have a gun, you keep it unloaded and locked away. As concerned members of the television community, we urge you to be just as careful with television. Kids don't always know what they're watching. That's why you should.
Welcome back to the Educational Forum. We're discussing Title IX. Catherine, research seems to suggest that women faculty, if they're in the science or math fields, they tend to teach much more than the men do. They seem to be at two-year institutions and not at four-year university and research institutions. Is that accurate?
It is accurate. The Government Accountability Office report did point that out, that when you look at the representation, the distribution of female faculty members, they are at the lower ranks of the teaching profession, and they are also more likely to go to institutions that focus more heavily on teaching rather than on research. They are also more likely to go to two-year schools where I think they might have more flexible teaching schedules and that kind of thing. Mm. And again, the report, as I was saying before the break, too, attributes this to personal choices.
Yeah.
But when you talk to people who are making these personal choices, what you find out is that they don't feel that the other things they want to do with their lives are compatible with a research and teaching career at a tier one doctoral university.
It drives me crazy because people say, well, that's what women choose.
Right.
Well, if women chose otherwise, we'd have no more children left on the planet. You know, really, get
right.
a clue.
Right.
Caitlin, any comments?
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely, I think it's definitely a balance between the women that I've seen in research and the women that are teaching and their families. And a lot of women professors that I've had don't have children, and that is their choice. And I don't know why they made that choice, but it's definitely very apparent that most don't.
Yeah, it's a trade-off.
Yeah, I think one of the really difficult things about the whole academic process that still, even though I've been around it for the last 9 years, that I just don't quite understand is the whole push to tenure. We have this window. When you start in teaching at a major doctoral university, you have 6 years to produce a book of research that is going to get you tenure so that people recognize you in your field, and then, of course, you know, you're set. You have tenure. And what I don't quite understand is why that six-year period is so important. And I don't know why people aren't asking that question. If you start, and as long as you at some point in time develop an appropriate book of research, even if you have to take some time off for kids, some time off for your family, that sort of thing, there isn't flexibility in that process to be able to do that. There is a six-year window. And that, I think, stymies a lot of people.
Sure it does.
You know?
And the big debate, unless I'm wrong about this, is, oh, there are some new universities that are going to give 6 extra months. Whoopee, okay?
Right.
Go have your children,
right,
and you can have six extra months to get tenure. That seems crazy.
Right, and what does 6 extra months do for you? In some cases, it's a six-month gap on your resume that other places who have an effect on the tenure evaluation process might not understand. Your colleagues who chose not to take advantage of that might look differently at you because you have tried to combine work and family. You have to, the educational institution has to, from the top down, create an environment that says this is okay, and it's not just for mothers, it's for people who have aging parents, it's for people who want to write a book for 4 months. It's, you know, to have a little bit of flexibility in the process so that we can have lives.
An interesting statistic. In the year 2004, women for the very first time have outnumbered male applicants to medical school. Mm-hmm. And previously, I had a chance to sit down with the former head of the AMA, the first woman to occupy that position, and talk with her about the increased number of women in the field of medicine. So I'd like to turn for a moment to that previously taped interview, and then I'll get your reactions.
If you look at the last 30 years of medicine, we see where only a small percentage of women went to medical school. In the 70s, it was probably less than 10% of most classes.
Was it really?
Today, we are at almost 50%, varying between 48 and 52%.
Hallelujah.
That's right. But if you look at the leadership roles, we're still not there.
Yeah.
Only a small portion of professors are women, less than 10% of the senior leadership, the deans, and even the associate deans are women. There are now women in every specialty in medicine, but the surgical specialties in particular have only a small portion of women there. Only in the last 15 years has society recognized that it was a much more pervasive problem than just who your doctor was. It was also what kinds of diseases were researched and how women physiologically responded. I can still remember the outrage when people said the huge decade-long study about the role of aspirin in cardiovascular disease had been done exclusively on men.
22,000 men, not one woman. I wanted you to come in here and tell me how that could be so.
Well, again, think about the society that we live in. No scientific group wanted to put a woman who might potentially be pregnant, eventually get pregnant, at any kind of risk. And so often it was simply easier to not have women in the study group. And then, of course, there was always, at least the scientific explanation, that women had these hormone cycles that were hard to predict, and therefore you wouldn't know what the research meant. Of course, those of us who were prescribing these same medications obviously had to deal with that. I think it was some closed minds that never even thought about the implications. And only as the number of women who were scientists and who were physicians increased, did they begin to raise the curtains on some of this and say, this doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
Nancy, you mentioned that admissions to medical school today are basically 50-50. At least we have women almost outnumbering men and fighting for the slots for medical school. Is this going to change medical education and ultimately medical services?
Absolutely. Already is.
It is.
Some ways are good. Women are finishing medical school and then deciding to have families, and they're saying, you know, I really don't want to work 120 hours a week. And I think that has had implications as men have said, well, you know, I do love practicing medicine, but maybe there are other aspects of life like having a family and participating as a...
And playing golf.
Playing, or my boat or my whatever.
Yeah, whatever.
And I think that's good. We are human beings and we are better physicians if we're well-rounded people.
Yeah.
On the other hand, we spend a lot of money training people to be physicians. And if, in fact, their intent is not to practice medicine, the state governments and the federal governments are investing in an individual who then is not going to give back. And by that, I don't mean monetarily. I mean because that skill set has been handed to someone who may or may not choose to use the skill set. And so it's a tough balance. I gave a talk recently at Texas A&M. And pointed out that we've not yet figured out how to share childbearing. That falls to women. And having had three children, I can appreciate the difficulty of balancing both childbearing and child rearing with a very demanding career. But I also recognize as a president of a state university that when I get state dollars, I have some obligation to use them well. I don't think we've found the right balance here. So it has changed both education and practice. And I don't think we've finished changing. I don't think we've finished answering those questions of what it means.
Your reaction?
I think one of the points she brought out, I think, was kind of interesting about how women are still making strides. But it is the same sort of issue that we're facing in engineering. They seem to have solved it a little more quickly at this point, with more women in leadership positions and medical schools and that sort of thing. But again, facing some very real issues as to what you can do finally once you get out and face the whole issue of family and how to have a life. Hopefully, it starts changing thinking when you look at medical schools and law schools and the number of graduates we have from there. If thinking can start changing there as to what an appropriate work life ought to look like, then maybe for the science faculty and the engineering faculty, and understand that I focus on the faculty because I think without the faculty, without the mentors, we're not going to have the students to go out and build spaceships and design new artificial knees and all that other kind of thing. So that's why I focus on the faculty in that regard. And I think that they've made some progress in that regard, and I think we can probably learn some lessons from that.
Caitlin?
I also thought her statement about surgery and specialties was interesting, and I think it comes back to the fact that those are probably specialties that require long, long days. And, you know, again, I think it's the family issue. You know, she mentioned that it was something where, although women are, we haven't really solved the child rearing balance issue, and I think that might be a major cause of it. You know, no one wants to be, you know, maybe these women who have families can't be called in the middle of the night to rush in and do these surgeries, and I think these are very demanding schedule wise, and I think that might be some of the issues.
Yeah, that's a big part of the problem. Mm-hmm. And there's some outright discrimination. Surgery, they have to hand you the scalpel. And there is some outright, you're going to watch another surgery because
right.
they don't want to give it to a woman. And that's going to change also.
Mm-hmm.
So I think you're right. It's a combination of the two factors. Let's think about the increase in medical schools, females, the increase in law school, now 50% mm-hmm. or greater, are women. Why is there not a similar increase in PhD programs in engineering, for example?
That's the $64,000 question. That's the one that we have struggled to try to understand. We've been trying to understand this particular question for decades. I think it's almost easier to explain why there has been an increase in the other fields. And I think if you look at the commonalities in the fields where we have seen an upswing in the enrollment of women, it's that they are basically helping professions. Even if you look at medicine, you see an increase of women in the family practice areas.
Right.
Right? That's the helping side of medicine as opposed to the cutting you up side of medicine. Law, very much a helping profession when done right, as you well know. Even in engineering, right now, our sophomore engineering class coming in this fall, for the very first time, we will have a majority female enrollment in our chemical engineering program. And the chemical engineering program is the program where most of our students will go on to careers in the biotech industry, the biomedical industry, the pharmaceutical industry, the helping industry, or they'll be working in environmental issues. That's our program there. So we are in schools that have biomedical engineering programs,
mm-hmm.
see huge enrollments of women in biomedical engineering programs. So I think we see that a lot of these fields will attract women. What
right.
we have to do is figure out why physics doesn't, why chemistry in large part doesn't, why mechanical engineering and electrical engineering don't, and figure out how to make people aware of how these can be helping professions in their own way.
That might be the $64,000 answer.
It might be.
Yeah. Caitlin, you are not a victim of discrimination in any way and got a lot of mentor support, et cetera. But do you think that there are a lot of female students that are recipients of a subtle message that you are, as a woman or as a young girl, not as good in science and math as your brother or as your friend who's a male?
Yeah, I definitely think it's out there. Again, it depends on who your interactions are with.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it depends on what the people in the leadership roles are teaching you and how they're treating you. And I was lucky, and I definitely don't think that's the case for everyone. And I mean, I definitely know of people that have had bad experiences and were turned off and never quite, you know, even
recovered.
Explored it. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Is it also true that if a guy gets a C in a science course, wow, that's a perfectly legitimate grade. I'm pleased with that.
Mm-hmm.
Let a girl get a C and, oh, no, they're right. You know, I possibly just am not cut out for a science degree. Do you think there's some of that going on?
I think it's definitely demanding being a girl in the sciences, and I think that especially my classmates at college were very, very driven women, very focused, and the guys that were in some of my classes were not all the time, and I don't know whether that was just my perception of it or who I, you know, hung out with or, you know, those kinds of things,
right.
But I mean, I can see how that might happen. I can't say for sure. It's definitely all the time. I know myself, I wasn't happy with a B anyway.
Yeah,
so
right.
I mean, you know, those kinds of things. I don't know. I mean, it's definitely a problem. I can see.
I think you can add to that that when a male student gets a bad grade, he tends to blame the professor. That person didn't teach me, didn't do this, whatever. Female student gets a bad grade, she blames herself. I didn't study hard enough, I didn't learn the right chapters, or whatever it is. And so there's also kind of a self-defeating mechanism that goes on with a lot of female students, at least a lot of the research has shown that. And you have to be pretty strong to counter those internal tendencies. If they are, who knows if they're wired or if they're put into you over time, but that does tend to be the way they react.
Different question, Catherine. Do the numbers, per se, suggest a Title IX violation? Can we look at percentage and simply numbers and come up with a conclusion that there is a Title IX violation?
That's one of the huge differences between athletics and the academic side mm-hmm. of Title IX. In athletics, if your student body is 50-50 male-female and your athletic programs are not, there needs to be a reason for it. Okay, otherwise, there's almost a presumptive Title IX violation. That's an oversimplification,
mm-hmm.
but it's almost presumptive that way. On the academic side, and by the way, the reason that is for athletics is because the athletic side of Title IX contemplates separate but equal athletic programs. It's a place in the law where we've said separate
That's right.
can be equal. In academic programs, we don't say that. We don't say separate but equal, we say equal. And so it's harder to identify what's going on. I think if you have an underrepresentation of women in a particular program, I also want to make it clear, this applies to men in programs dominated by women, such as elementary education and nursing and that kind of thing as well. Title IX goes both ways. If you have an underrepresentation, I think that's where you have to start looking at why. And let's say in an engineering program, you have an SAT math requirement of 600 in order to get into the engineering program. And a higher proportion of men who take the exam, and I'm just throwing this out, I don't know that this is true, but a higher proportion of men who take the exam get over 600 than women. So you're necessarily limiting your pool. But other studies show that SAT scores overpredict male performance and underpredict female performance. So is a 600 in an SAT math score really an accurate prerequisite for your engineering program? I would say it probably isn't. So you can look at your program and say, okay, we're using this as a guideline. Maybe this isn't the right guideline. Maybe we ought to rethink our guideline, and that might alter your participation
sure.
in the program somehow.
Is gender ever, and I always tell the law students, when I use the word ever, you know what the answer is
right.
going to be. But is it ever a permissible disqualification for a faculty position within a university?
Probably not for a faculty position. Gender, Title IX does carve out an exception when gender is what's called in the law bona fide occupational qualification.
Mm-hmm.
An attendant in a locker room, for instance. Okay, you can restrict hiring a female locker room attendance position to women. An all-women's residence hall, the director of that residence hall, you can restrict to be a woman or a man, you know, on the other side. That's about it in Title IX, and you really have to make sure that you've got a good reason for why you're carving out that particular exemption for that particular job.
And unfortunately, we need to take another break. When we come back, we're going to look at another previously taped segment where we look at whether girls and boys at the grade school level should have separate education in science and in math. And then I'll look forward to both of your comments on that.
Okay.
Please stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Morgan here. So, hi.
Right now? Okay.
The itsy-weensy spider climbed up the water spout. Down came the rain and washed the spider out. Out came the sun and dried up all the rain. And the itsy-weensy spider climbed up the spout again.
I love you, Daddy.
I love you, sweetheart.
Family. Isn't it about time?
What can I say? It's my girl.
From the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints.
There's a time and a place to be aggressive. Now that's cool. That's uncool. Cool. Uncool. Cool. Now that's uncool. Take it out on the field, not on each other. There's nothing cool about violence.
Kids aren't afraid of other kids or people with different color skin. That's because kids know there are other things. Worse things. Bigger things to be afraid of.
Like monsters from outer space!
Remember, friends come in all colors.
I don't know that I think we have enough data out here to say that it has to be all one way or another. As an organization, AAUW has said that we support public education and we support co-ed public education. That it is good teaching methods and awareness from instructors, it is smaller classrooms and strategies used in teaching that make for effective education whether you are male or female. Now, having said that, we do know, and the studies have supported, that there certainly is gender stereotyping in the classrooms, and different groups get different kinds of attention and get reinforced for different things. Some students are encouraged more to look at some academic courses and not at others, to pursue some majors and not necessarily other majors. So there is a difference in what is happening in the classroom. And I think that there is a time and a place where single-sex classes may be very appropriate for given individuals and given topics. As the norm, and to go to that across the board, I don't know that I think we would support that at all.
Let me ask the panel one more question, and then we'll go to the audience. Connie, I see you've got a comment first.
I wanted to ask Ms. Van Ness, how do you handle the Title IX issue? Because the only time, my understanding is that undergraduate institutions are exempted from Title IX is in their overall admissions policy. Once they offer a program, they have to offer the program without regard to sex.
Well, that's the other piece of the VMI decision as well, because the Supreme Court also talked about what Title IX means in terms of, this is the 1972 law that was enacted to provide equal educational opportunity in universities to women students. And Title IX is very interesting because it's a gender-neutral statute. So it says that we would provide equal educational opportunities regardless of sex in higher education. But as the law students in the audience might know, every statute that is enacted by Congress is interpreted by cases decided by the federal courts and is also applied through regulations that are issued by the, at this point, the Department of Education, they're in the Code of Federal Regulations. And the Code of Federal Regulations very clearly says that that separate sexes, programs that address sexes separately may be appropriate if there's an educational purpose to be served, or if there are health and privacy reasons. So that's how we still have male and female locker rooms in higher, in universities and colleges. But there hasn't been a whole lot yet that tests what does it mean if there's a good pedagogical reason for separating the sexes. And perhaps Professor Daly's case is going to help sort of flesh out what that really means.
Let me ask this question, then we'll go to Mike in the audience. Studies have shown that girls test lower in math and sciences. So some schools have separated the genders for this very reason. Now, does this demean girls by suggesting that girls cannot keep up, they need special handling to keep pace with the boys?
I think that from at least from a constitutional point of view, part of the problem is that in Brown versus the Board of Education, the Supreme Court said separate but equal has no place in education. And the reason was not just that in that particular circumstances there was no equality, because there wasn't even an attempt to justify the segregation, the Topeka school systems, on the basis that we are giving the blacks an equal education to what we're giving the whites. They didn't even try it. The point was, it's the state-imposed separation in and of itself. You can't have equal if the state says you're being separate. So it doesn't matter what kind of program you're, if that's really what Brown meant, and that's what it meant at the time, I think, then I think we have to realize that that's not what it means anymore. If we're going to let separate but equal, then it's really not the problem. It's really not separating the sexes or separating the races that creates the stigma and the inferiority. And in fact, there are certain circumstances under which separating the sexes or separating the races are good things. And if that's the case, then Brown is no longer Brown, and we've moved off of it. And I disagree. I think if that's what Brown meant, separate in and of itself brands one group as inferior to another, depending on the purpose, then we can't allow it for anything, sex, race, religion, or any other reason, without a compelling interest.
But the question was, why don't girls do as well in school, in secondary school, in math and sciences as the boys? I have Ed here, who has been an educator for a number of years, and he has a strong opinion on that topic.
I think one of the panelists had already addressed it, the fact that the teachers themselves are not addressing the problem. It's not having that girls are less capable, because a lot of the studies have shown that girls are more capable in mathematics at the elementary level. They lose the interest because the people directing the programs, teaching the programs, aren't keeping that interest going. I think separating them is just going to perpetuate the difference, or the stereotypical difference between male and female. I think addressing the educational process and making people sensitive to gender issues and teaching them how to teach co-ed classes appropriately will provide the need.
Well, how do you teach co-ed classes appropriately then?
By treating everybody the same. Your expectations are the same from everybody as far as the academic is necessary. I'm talking at an elementary high school level. When you get older, there are choices that can be made, and I have no problem with separation at a higher level in a private sector. I have a problem when public money says that one group is different than the other group.
Catherine?
Well, I've sort of shifted my thinking on this particular subject as I've looked more deeply into what we really are doing if we choose to separate men and women or boys and girls at points in the educational process. I'm the product of an all-girls high school, and I had a fantastic experience in the high school that I think helped me when I got into an engineering program in college. That was my parents' choice at the time. It really wasn't mine. It turned out well, but it was my parents' choice. And so I can see the benefits of it when it's your choice. But there have also been studies now, Carnegie Mellon, some researchers at Carnegie Mellon were looking at why women weren't as involved in computer science as men. I think they had 7% women in their computer science programs. And one of the theories that they thought was that women learned computer science differently than men, so maybe we should teach them separately from men. They've since modified that theory a little bit, and what they've discovered is that women are prepared differently to learn computer science. So what they need to do is have different paths into the computer science curriculum. But those different paths are not restricted just to women. And by opening up four different paths into their computer science curriculum, they've actually opened up the curriculum to men who also might not have thought about that curriculum because they might have had different preparation. The point of that is that women may well learn differently than men, and girls may well learn differently than boys. But by being sensitive to those different learning styles, what you can do is open up a curriculum to more people, both men and women, both girls and boys. We've seen that in our own engineering program. When we made modifications to our first year program to address the low retention of women in our first year program, we saw not only the retention of women skyrocket, but the retention of men went up as well.
Wonderful.
It was a better educational program for everybody. And so I think that's where, when you start to separate out, you're going to actually disadvantage both groups in different ways.
Caitlin, how do you feel about separate education for girls and boys in math and science?
I definitely agree that there's that I don't think it's a very good idea, and I think that separating causes more problems than it probably will solve. And Maybe there are differences, and but I don't think by separating them that you're going to solve anything, that you're going to, you know, change anything. You need to address the issues that are the reasons why they're being treated differently, and treat them differently, but in the same setting.
Different question. We've talked about women in faculty roles. We've talked about students that are women now in these disciplines. How do we get, for example, women engineers into the top jobs out in the workplace?
By, first of all, getting them in the door. And so we have to start graduating a lot more of them. And I think that's why we've been focusing on faculty and students, because we can't have engineers out there in the workplace if we haven't gotten them through school, and faculty are a key part of that process. But we are seeing now from industry renewed attention at bringing more women into various industry jobs and moving them up through the upper echelons of management as the corporate culture. There are some corporations that are very, very good at this. As a corporate culture adapts to people who have lives outside the office. Mm-hmm. And corporations are actually now finding that bringing women into engineering roles are enabling them to do things that men would not have thought of. And this is not a slam on men, but for instance, Volvo just announced the design about a year ago, a design of an automobile that's been designed all by women for women. And among other things, and this is a little silly, but men would not have thought of this, the headrest has a cutout for your ponytail clip. So those are the kinds of things where, you know, when your ponytail is hitting up against the headrest, it's annoying, right? Men don't have that. So you get different design features when you bring in women. We're very close in geographic proximity to the Whirlpool Corporation. Whirlpool designs and builds kitchen appliances and washers and dryers and that sort of thing. Whirlpool is just now getting around to integrating women into their engineering workforce in a big way. And when you think about the logic of that,
yeah.
Who buys kitchen appliances, who uses kitchen appliances, women, and men have been designing these kitchen appliances for decades. So as a business decision, corporations, women have more purchasing power than they used to have. As a business decision, corporations need to bring in women to help them get to that market segment. And they can't get enough women to come into industry right now because we're not graduating enough of them.
And sure, the demand is there.
Right.
Totally different topic. Lawrence Summers, his comments about the ineptitude of women in certain fields. I have two questions with respect to that. Number one, what do you think? And number two, is it going to help or hinder women's progress?
I think he had some interesting things to say. I wish he hadn't said them the way he said them, because the way he said them provoked reactions that have now, to answer your second question, I think limited our debate. Because I think one of the things he said that caught my attention was that, you know, men are at the higher reaches of, let's say, IQ tests and SAT scores and that kind of thing. You have more men up on the higher ends of those scores. You also have more men at the lower end of those scores. The distribution curve of men for SATs would be wide and flat. For women, it would be narrow and tall, because more women are grouped up toward the midpoint. My question would be, the question I would want to ask is, do you really have to be all the way up here at the high end of the spectrum to be successful in science and engineering? Basically, what he was saying was there aren't enough women in the high end of the spectrum. Why can't the spectrum be a little wider?
Yeah.
We can't ask that question right now because there was such negative reaction to his comments. He also said something along the lines of how women just can't cut it in the higher end academic environments. Those weren't his exact words, but you know.
I must have turned the radio off by then.
I read the whole thing and I found it in there when I read it. He said something about that, but then that leads me to the question of why do we have an environment in which half our population can't succeed? You know, and we can't ask that question anymore either, because the response is, of course women can succeed in that environment. And they can, women have. But my question is, why should they? You know, it's an acknowledged negative environment in a lot of regards. Why don't we change the environment and open the doors? And so that's what I think. He could have opened up a huge discussion on a lot of these factors, but right now, I think we're kind of forestalled from actually looking at the really interesting parts of what he had to say.
And regrettably, we're out of time. We're going to close the show by talking to two former astronauts and hear whether girls still dream of being astronauts.
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. We go for main engine start. We have main engine start and the ignition and... liftoff of STS-7 and America's first woman astronaut.
Do you believe that little girls today dream of being astronauts?
Oh, sure. Absolutely. I do a lot of lecturing with Girl Scouts, with schools and libraries, and boy, you ought to see the hands that go up. How did you get where you are? How can I do it? And so it is starting with elementary, junior high, starting in with the math, the science, the engineering, all these great ideas. You could kick in any door you want to do if you have the drive that wanted.
Irene, what would you tell the young girls in the audience that dream of flying, perhaps becoming astronauts?
I'd say take care of your health, be very athletic, get at least a four-year degree in some aviation or aerospace technology, and meanwhile start in pilot training as soon as they can, and get into the military, and try and get into jet test pilot school, because that's one of the requirements, and go from there. But the backup, the academics are very important.
What type of academic training do you think is best for one with those types of dreams?
Physics, astronomy, any of the engineering degrees that would apply. Astronomy is very important. I took some of that as a secondary at Napa College, and I don't quite have the brain work for chemistry, but I enjoyed it. And just hang with it. And do not get married.
Or certainly don't learn how to cook anyway, right?
Because then you're stuck in one place. And in aviation, you got to be able to, tomorrow, pick up the bag and go over here.
And it's been worth it for you, though, hasn't it?
Yes. I have two cats.
Homework with my friends.
Aren't I supposed to?
Just call to say hi, that's all.
Hi?
Family.
That's all?
Yep.
Isn't it about time?
Dad, that's so cool.
From the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints.
You know,